Le piador.
Le piador.
Just when they thought it was safe to break out of prison. Home Alone 2, Lost in New York.
Citizen, because a watch should show more than seconds, minutes, and hours.
Glamour-puss!
No. Catwoman! Oh, go on! Oh,
Pussy-boots!
Oh, Catwoman! Oh, no.
Puss-in-boots!
No. Pictionary, the most fun you can have with a pencil.
Meow.
Stains like black currant juice are really tough. But Persil Micro Non-Bio works better on those difficult stains than any other non-bio powder. So, guests will be wearing their favourite dress time and time again.
European 2 starts here. Any questions?
What kind of breakfast is this?
I asked for shredded wheat.
Shredded wheat is 100% whole wheat. No other cereal gives you more whole wheat goodness.
Hold on, Gaston.
He's the one that eats twa around here.
Shredded wheat and new shredded wheat, bite-sized, 100% whole wheat.
Coffee, mate.
Oh, haven't you got any milk?
Not sure I'm going to like this.
It's always a first time.
Nice. Very nice.
All right, then. Have a good Christmas. Ooh, I nearly to put your present back.
I was wondering.
I want you to promise me that you're not going to open that before tomorrow.
I promise.
I know you. You will.
I promise, 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 promise. I've got to go. I won't open it. Hello? Shush, Sparky.
Thanks to Cellnet Lifetime, you can be closer than ever this Christmas.
Hello?
Gotcha.
I've opened it.
With Cellnet, you're never far apart. Ring 0800 21 4000.
The new Sony phone. It could become more popular than a pair of slippers.
In my capable hands, this place will grow and blossom.
Apparently, Wesley's found a money tree.
You won't remember him from that. You won't even recognise yourself.
And talking of recognising people...
I love it.
I've got one of Mum's old nighties on.
Poor Monty. Has everything gone to seed? Tomorrow at 8 on TVS.
I'm standing on the top of the world, at the North Pole.
You must remember this. A kiss is just a kiss, a sigh is just a sigh. The fundamental things apply as time goes by.
This perfect moment was created for Harvey's Bristol Cream, the best sherry in the world.
What's your diet's cost far too much, Dosh? That's a rumour we're now going to quash. With radio rentals, it ain't monumental.
So your wallet won't shrink in a wash.
Stay contented. Get radio rented.
The Philips Lady Shave range.
from the makers of Saturnelle. Open your mouth, Sergeant. Come on, open wide.
For one young cop, this is turning out to be an interesting case.
They are also an aphrodisiac.
Temptation.
I've got to go, this is crazy.
And danger go hand in hand. In the world of the supergrass, no one is safe from betrayal.
You just blew it, son. Now get out, stay out, stay out of my sight.
Framed, tomorrow at 9.
This is TVS Now, news at 10.
The headquarters of ITN, News at 10, with Trevor MacDonald.
MPs ask, can the Princess of Wales really become Queen? Yeltsin demands a referendum on who runs Russia. Major tries unraveling the difficulties of the Edinburgh summit. And hundreds fear dead in a Bolivian mudslide, an exclusive ITN report. Good evening. After the drama of yesterday's announcement, deeper questions today at Westminster. Can the Princess of Wales really still become Queen now that she's separated from the Prince? Yesterday, the Prime Minister said she could, but many MPs disagree. They insist that could never happen. The royal couple began their new separate lives today with separate engagements in different parts of London. David Chater reports.
They were going their separate ways today. As the Prince of Wales left Kensington Palace, the Princess drove in. The Prime Minister reaffirmed to the Cabinet that the official separation had no constitutional implications, but his own backbench MPs are saying it could make a mockery of the monarchy.
This is far more serious than I think people really believe. We're not just talking about the personal foibles of members of the royal family. We're talking about the survival of the monarchy.
It seems to be a bit daft, to be perfectly honest. I can't imagine a situation where Charles is crowned king and Diana is separately crowned the queen.
The prince and princess are still under the same roof for the moment, but the arrival of the removal men is imminent. For the prince today, it was business as usual. Continuing his round of official engagements, he seemed unaffected by the controversy. And for the princess, a speech to a charity lunch, recalling the trauma of the day Prince William had his skull fractured in a golfing accident at school. It was a day that first exposed the divisions in her marriage, a day when the Prince of Wales left her alone in the hospital while he went out to the opera on an official engagement.
That period of shock and numbness, waiting to find out how bad the injury is, has to be experienced to be fully understood. Thankfully, William made a very rapid recovery.
The Princess of Wales sent her good wishes tonight to the Princess Royal and Commander Tim Lawrence, but she won't be attending their wedding this weekend. That decision is being seen as a deliberate snub. The media spotlight shows no sign of moving away from her yet.
In relation to the children, we will definitely be laying off. In relation to Diana and Charles, who are major public figures, not only in this country, but all over the world, and make news everywhere they go, we will be continuing to cover them.
And tonight, the Duchess of York spoke about her exposure in the press. In an interview to be screened in America, she admitted, "I brought it all on myself."
In one respect, at least, the prince and princess are like any other couple involved in a separation. Friends are dividing into different camps. Their courtiers and advisers are dividing too. ITN's Caroline Kerr looks at how their separate courts will operate in practice.
For some time now, the Princess of Wales has been clearly trying to establish her own court. Her trip to Paris last month, which included a 40-minute meeting with President Mitterrand, proved just how well she can operate without Prince Charles. Now, some commentators are worried she may be attempting to openly compete with him.
The princess is a very competitive animal. She always has been. Now she has her own quite separate court, a court over which she is completely in charge. There is a big danger that she could attempt to eclipse her husband.
Prince Charles has been upstaged in the past. Last year he gave a keynote speech complaining about standards of education.
It is almost incredible that in Shakespeare's land, one child in seven leaves primary school functionally illiterate.
She spoke the same day about AIDS and stole the show.
HIV does not make people dangerous to know. So you can shake their hands and give them a hug. Heaven knows, they need it.
If clashes occurred when they had regular planning meetings, they could become much worse now. The daily running of the royal household is all organised, of course, at Buckingham Palace, where the Queen has a full complement of staff. But just a short distance away at St James's Palace, the Prince and Princess of Wales will operate separate offices. The Prince's key people will be Richard Aylard, his private secretary, and his detective, Colin Trimming, who's now a close personal friend. Advising the Princess at her court will be Patrick Jeffson, her former equerry, and Ken Wharfe, her trusted bodyguard. Dickie Arbiter, once press secretary to both, will most likely now work exclusively for the Prince. This division of staff is fraught with danger.
If those two courts start to be rivals of each other, start to be hostile to each other, then I think that could be very damaging.
The Prince of Wales has a long-established reputation as an ambassador for Britain. His supporters deny that's in jeopardy now. But foreign governments will have to choose whether to invite him or his more glamorous wife. And commentators suspect the Prince will lose out.
President Boris Yeltsin threw a constitutional hand grenade into Russian politics today, demanding a referendum to choose between him and Congress. It puts the long power struggle between Mr. Yeltsin and the Russian parliament on a collision course. Today, the president accused his opponents of attempting a creeping coup. They talked of putting him on trial. This report from a divided Russia is by our Moscow correspondent, James Mates.
Calls for action on bedsit safety after two die in fire. Life sentence for killer of Hove mother Marion Rilke. And is any of this yours? Good evening. A Kent MP has joined the call for new safety measures after two men were killed by a blaze that swept through a block of bedsitter flats in Thanet. It's the latest in a series of tragic fires in beds and in bedsitters and flats in the southeast. David Forsdyke reports.
The blaze swept through this disused hotel with such ferocity that fire officers reported that the inside glass doors had melted. It began on the ground floor of the building, which was once a hotel, and then bedsits, used mostly for single people on social security. A fortnight ago, it was repossessed. The two men who died were living here without permission or electricity.
There was no power connected last night, and we believe it to have been disconnected about a week ago.
What is your understanding about how the place had been lit by the residents?
There is some evidence that residents had used candles for lighting.
This is the sort of blaze the fire brigade warns can happen in blocks of bedsits. But in the private housing domain, the authorities have little power to enforce fire safety regulations.
With regard to houses in multiple occupation, there is far less strict control. And in fact, the fire authority, the fire brigade, has no direct involvement with the enforcement of that legislation. So to that extent, we have very little power to, in actual fact, ensure safety standards in these places.
It's understood the men who died in the fire are both middle-aged. They're thought to be Robert Ed Wicker, who was known locally as Bobsy, and Thomas Young, who was known to friends as Fergie. Buildings with multiple occupation like this former hotel are all over the southeast. In Thanet alone, there are 1,500 blocks of bedsits. A fire in this one gave those who died little chance of any escape.
At the moment, it's too easy for any small hotel or guest house, with or without adequate facilities, to change to hostel use. I have no particular objection to a good hotel changing to a good hostel, provided that they have the facilities and the fire precautions.
A man who forced his way into a woman's home and cut her throat as she tried to ring for help is tonight behind bars. Jailing 20-year-old Gary Gregory for life, the judge praised brilliant police work for catching him. Alan Clark reports.
Gary Gregory, an unemployed man from Hove, forced his way into the home of 51-year-old Marion Rilke and slit her throat. She was found when an anxious friend called to find out why she'd failed to pick up her 9-year-old daughter from West Hove Junior School. Mrs. Rilke was found lying in a pool of blood. Her phone was off the hook. An electronic print showed how Mrs. Rilke had desperately tried to dial 999, but had only managed to dial the first two nines. Police caught up with Gregory when they learned he'd been knocking on doors, trying to talk his way into other houses and asking directions to a road in Hove. A house-to-house team went to that area with an artist's impression. People who matched the picture, including Gregory, were blood tested. Traces of blood found at the scene matched Gregory's DNA profile. The court was told the chances of it belonging to someone else were 1 in 1,400 million. After the trial, Mrs. Rilke's relatives welcomed the verdict. They said they had nothing but contempt for Gregory. There was praise for the police investigation. The judge said the community's in debt to the officers. And prosecutor Robert Seabrook QC said it was exceptionally astute detective work. It was a thorough, efficient and imaginative inquiry. At 4 o'clock this afternoon, Gregory was led into a police van to spend Christmas and a life sentence in prison.
A fisherman has told how he helped to drag two pilots to safety after their Cessna plane had crashed into the sea. The two were spotted clinging to the wing of the aeroplane by the crew of the fishing boat, the Valiant. The plane sank off Hastings only a few moments after the two men were pulled out of the sea by 26-year-old David Curtis and his friend John Martin. Both are off-duty lifeboatmen.
We've been out fishing and we're coming home. And all of a sudden, this aeroplane drew up alongside us at sea level, flew in front of us and ditched into the sea. And by the time we got there, the two fellas in the plane had got out and were hanging onto the wing, and the plane was sinking. And the plane sunk, we got alongside and we pulled them out.
More than 300 jobs have been saved after a management buyout at a Kent paper mill. Empire Paper at Greenhithe was owned by a Norwegian group, but closure looked imminent when the company started to lose money. Sussex police have taken out a massive insurance premium to stage a display of antiques. The valuables are worth £333,000, as Natalie Gray reports.
The antiques fill two warehouses and are the results of two police raids in Brighton and mid-Sussex. Two men and a woman have been charged with theft following one of the raids. A man is helping with inquiries following the other. Police aren't sure if the items have been stolen, but they're urging anyone who's been burgled to see if they recognise any of the valuables on show to contact them immediately.
We're particularly interested in these two items, which are made of ivory. As you see, they're heavily carved. One is some form of tankard with a lid, and the other is a small shrine. One of the other items that we have is this silver salver with, as you can see, the writing on the back. Reuben Fletcher Esquire died 27th of April 1824 on his 70th year.
Police say their job would be made easier if people marked their valuables. Meanwhile, all the items here will be put on public display in the Territorial Army Barracks in Dyke Road, Brighton from 10 until 4 on Saturday and Sunday. Detectives have taken out insurance of £350,000 to cover the massive haul.
And that's it from the TVS newsroom for tonight. We'll be back with more news for the South East at 9:55 in the morning. Good night.
Good evening. Well, the region of high pressure which has been hanging around today is actually going to drift slowly southwards towards France ahead of a frontal system that will be bringing rain to the north and into the Midlands during tomorrow afternoon. As far as tonight is concerned and our part of the world, temperatures are likely to drop down close to freezing in one or two places, which raises the risk of frost, and there could also be some fog patches developing. Tomorrow, the winds will tend to become a little more westerly as the day wears on. Another cloudy day, fairly quiet day. Best temperatures about 7 Celsius, probably on the eastern side of the region. The general outlook is for that rain to reach us late tomorrow night. Good night. Here's the summary.
The nightmare's over.
Looks like she's alive.
Or is it?
My mommy always said there were no monsters. But there are.
History.
I am not going back, and I mean it.
Has a habit.
They'll be dark soon, and they mostly come at night.
Of repeating itself.
I said no!
Your wildest dreams.
I'm not going to leave you, Newt. That's a promise.
Can and do.
come true. Aliens coming soon on TVS. Next.